Good evening, everyone. Hope last week you had a happy Purim, and last Wednesday we were not here because of the reading of the Megillah. So we make a little longer lecture today with your permission. So since I don't have a second lecture today, as usual, we can steal some more time today. We are in our Psalm series. We arrived already to chapter 34. We will try to do a few more today from 35 on. The last we read, when we finished the last lecture 2 weeks ago, we spoke about many dangers around the righteous person, and constantly Hashem will save him from each one, will reserve him, not one of his bones will be broken. The wicked people will pay for what they did. Those who put the trap in front of the righteous people, this will be used against themselves. Hashem redeemed the souls of his servants, his followers. Someone that trusts him and follow him will never be found guilty. That was the last three verses of the last chapter 34. We will continue now with chapter 35. a little summary about chapter 35 is that the language of this mizmor is a person that his lovers and friends betrayed him. Everybody understands that when your enemy is fighting against you, you are upset, but not so much, because you expected it. You didn't expect any better from them. But when the people you love the most, when the people you do so much for, and the people that you consider them as your friend, and they always declare that they are, you know, your best friends, when they stick a knife in your back, that's already much more painful when one of your enemies is attacking you. Even 10 enemies will come and do all kinds of bad things to you, will not be equal to one of your friends that betrayed you. Everybody knows that. That's the way of the world. That's why many places here in Psalms, we see that the pain of King David for what was done to him is not because of what was done to him. It's because who was doing it to him. Such as Achitophel, his son Avshalom, you know, Doeg HaEdomi, all these people that, you know, were very close with him. And eventually they all turned against him from jealousy, from different reasons, for politics that they had. And because of that, as results of that, they went and tried to arm him. So this chapter 35, describing, you know, people who try to make false accusation against him for sins that he never committed. Also complaining about the ungratefulness of his enemies. And they betrayed, you know, how they betrayed him. He thought them as his brothers and his friends, and was praying for their success, praying that Hashem will have mercy on them, not knowing who they really are. That's a very, very painful thing. You pray for someone, and then he go and sell you out or stick a knife in your back. It's very painful, right? And now, when they see him down and he's sick, what do they do? Not only they don't have any guilty feelings, or, you know, they realize, how can we be so ungrateful? None of these things. They're actually happy. They want to see him sinking even lower and lower. This is a summary of this mizmor. This mizmor is divided to three different parts. And they're more or less equal, you know, as far as how many verses there are in each one of them. And the main thing in this is that the conclusion of this mizmor, is this chapter, is that the writer of this chapter is accepting on himself, once his salvation will arrive, to praise Hashem. So let's see some of the words here in this mizmor. One more thing before we translate it, literally, the Sforno, one of the important commentators on Tanakh, he said that King David wrote this mizmor while he was running away from his son Avshalom. The Radak was about almost 500 years ago. He is thinking that this mizmor is actually when King David is not running from Avshalom, he's running from Shaul. So we have a disagreement between two commentaries. One thinks that this mizmor is written as results of running away from his son Avshalom, and Radak thinks that it was actually while he was running from King Shaul, King Saul. He starts the mizmor in a plural language, but once he arrived to verse 8, he's turning into single language and referring to Achitophel. Achitophel was a very big chacham in Torah, but also at the same time was a wicked person. And that's what Chazal warned the most from. Someone who knows a lot of Torah but is evil and wicked, that's the most dangerous thing. So he's referring to Achitophel, u'miachel shetavo alav shoah, wishing him that he's going to get the worst punishment the way he deserved to get. You know, after he offered Avshalom to go and take the wives of King David, of his father, the wives of his father. The king had up to 18 wives and pilakshim, and kosher mistresses. What does it mean, kosher mistress? It's everything like a wedding, but without a ketubah. She can have children with her, the children are perfectly legitimate. Everything 100% like a wife. The only difference is that she doesn't give a document like a wife. That's the only difference, but all other rights are equal. So once Achitophel told him that that's what he should do and that will make his father collapse, he's wishing for Achitophel to get measure for measure for what he have done to him. Because remember, when a wicked person wants to go against a righteous person and hurt him, sometimes he have observations. He's scared. After all, he say, well, you know what, in the end I'm going to pay the price. However, if he find another chacham that back him up, that gives him a lot of energy to go and fight against the other chacham. I have someone to back me up. So it's one chacham against another chacham, who's to say that your chacham is better than mine? That's, by the way, sometimes the most dangerous things. We can see now in Israel that that's really the case here. That all the groups of the religious people who run for the election in the Israeli government, which will happen in less than a week, they all split to two. The Ashkenazim, the Sfaradim, they all split to two groups. And each group is backed up with someone who knows a lot of Torah. So you come and say, how can you do such a thing? You say, talk to my rabbi. You come to his rabbi, say, well, ask your rabbi, how can you do such a thing? So that's really the most dangerous things. When you have one very big chacham against complete ignorant person, then you understand who gives you the right advice. When you have two ones and they disagree with each other, that creates a problem. And remember that no matter how big are the rabbis are, they still are people, and they have their own opinions. And each one thinks that because this person did A, B, C positive, I should endorse him. And the other one thing, the other person did also positive, so I should endorse him. And sometimes they both right. He's good and he's good. Only Hashem knows who is a little better. It's very difficult for people to know, because even a rabbi, he has a student. He doesn't know all the things his student does in his life. He can only see what he already know, what he saw in his own eyes. But can he swear that his student doesn't make sense? Of course not. Unless it was Eliyahu Navi or someone that has Ruach HaKodesh, it's a different story. Then he knows from Ruach HaKodesh, it's like a prophecy. But without it, how does he know what he does? Only Hashem knows what a person does in hidden rooms. Everything that he does, only Hashem knows. Even a prophet, he can know certain things about you that no one else can. But he doesn't know everything about you, because the prophecy that he gets doesn't include everything. It only includes what Hashem told him. And Hashem is not binded to tell the prophet or the rabbi everything about his student. Because Hashem has his reasons. One of the reasons that HaKadosh Baruch Hu made people unable to read people's mind, or that we cannot know what, when a person speaks to you, you don't know what he's thinking. There are certain, you don't know the future. There's reasons for that. Why Hashem made it? Because if people would have these things, it will eliminate the free choice. Everything will be clear. There will be a lot of shame in the world. And because of the shame, no one will make a scene. If a person knew that every sin he does in hidden rooms, everybody on the street can see it on him as soon as he comes out, nobody would ever make a scene. No one. Who would make a scene? You come out to the street, million people look at you like this. They just know what you did an hour ago. Nobody would do it. But the problem is that people ask, nobody knows, I can fool the whole world. Now you may come and say, okay, but what about Hashem? Fool the world, fine. So you earn some more time, nobody knows about you. But what about Hashem? The point is that the way Hashem did the world, made the world, is that we don't have the understanding that Hashem is watching us all the time. To get to this understanding, you have to invest many, many hours every week in learning and learning and learning. While you're learning, you have this understanding. As soon as you stop for a day or two, this understanding goes away from you. And it's not something that you gain and it stays by you forever. You can't take it for granted. Yirat Shamayim, fear from God, understanding that there's an eye who watches you, there's an ear who listens to you, and everything you do is recorded, only exists by the person when he's reminded constantly. And the only way that a person is reminded constantly, if his CD play all the time in his car and he spends hours every day in the car, he constantly hears strong ethical lectures who keeps reminding him every 2-3 minutes about the importance that Hashem is watching, don't make any crimes, be careful. Everything is recorded. That's why it keeps the person righteous. But as soon as the person stops listening to that and goes to sport and to the news and to the rest of his nonsense, give him 2-3 days maximum, you begin to see what severe sins he begins to do. You see it right away. So if people don't listen to the CDs, they can learn from the book. If they read Tehilim, it's a constant reminder. Every verse here, it's a reminder. If you learn in a parasha, every once in a while you come to a story that shakes you up. Wow, look what happened to this person. I'm much worse than him. So if that's what happened to him, imagine what would happen to me if I won't do tshuva. So that's a constant reminder. But many people want to run away from Torah and Musar, especially Musar. They don't like speakers who pinch on your nerve constantly. They want soft and funny speakers that will help them to go to hell faster. Why? Because they're going to put them to sleep. They numb them. They think, I'm learning Torah, I'm such a tzaddik. But not once in 20 years he's shaking his heart, once even. Nothing. Everybody is righteous. Everyone is so sweet. You're all wonderful Jews. Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai and Rabbi Akiva prepare a chair between them for you in heaven. Don't worry. You know, Rabbi such and such will pull you from Gehenom because you're going to have a little bit hair over here. They spread all this nonsense in the world and make such huge damage to Jews. Destroy the world with their nonsense. You know, and the problem is that the world has more and more fools who buy their nonsense. Not necessarily because they believe in them, because it's comfortable to relax the conscience that on my next sin I won't feel as guilty as. But when I listen to this speaker or to that one or to this one, they make me feel horrible. It's very awkward. I constantly suffer in my heart for my sins. I don't want him to remind me what a wicked guy I am. So what's the solution? To run away from the truth. And one day the truth will slap in your face. And now you're going to have to start paying for all your crimes. So what's better? To deal with that slowly, slowly, one by one now. And one day you're going to be clear and nice and in a very good shape. Or one day you're going to get a huge bill. Very, very long receipts. It goes all the way from here to the other side of the world. And you go 1, 2, 5, 10, 50, 100, 5,000, 50,000, 1,000,000. What is this, Hashem? This is the list of all your sins. Day such and such, hour, from 12 midnight to 1 a.m., from 1 a.m. to 2 a.m., from 2 a.m. Come on, Hashem, such a long list, there was not enough cash register to print such a bill. You know, all the cash registers in the world cannot print the bill of one Rasha, of one wicked person. So he's wishing all the wars to this Rasha, Achitofel, for giving the advice to his son Avshalom that was standing in the entrance of Jerusalem and convincing all the people that come to have a trial by the court of King David, which was a judge. And he said to them, do you really think my father has time to give you justice? Do you think my father will care about you? You have to support me. When I'll be the king, I'm gonna give time to each one of you miserable people. My father is a big shot. He doesn't have time for people like you. Vote for me, support me. I wanna make a revolution here. Once I'll be the king, I promise you I will not forget what you did for me. Sounds like the elections today. You know? Somebody very big in Israel, I got a phone call that is about to call me any minute. I said, what does he want from me? First of all, how does he even know about me? He's one of the biggest important rabbis in the world. He said, he heard about you now in Israel a lot. He asked us if we can connect you to him. So we gave him your telephone number. I said, what does he want from me? He said, he wants you to endorse this person for the election. And the person that he wanted me to endorse is the last person I want to endorse. You know? So I said to him, tell him that there's no point of calling me because I won't endorse that person. So he said, it's worth it for you. Do you know what it is to have connection with such an important rabbi? It's one of the biggest in the world. Anything you want in one phone call, he fixed. I said, yeah, I didn't want to say to him, no, I'm not involved with this nonsense. I said to him, listen, I don't want to get involved in the election. It's going to be very bad for my reputation if I put my nose there. If people ask me in person who to vote for, I tell them my opinion. But other than that, to go public, I'm not interested. So after all that, they didn't give up. They came back with a solution. They said, okay, don't say to endorse this person, but at least say for all the people to endorse religious people. So for that's of course. That's regardless of what you ask. That's my opinion, regardless. Who should they vote? For people who mechalel Shabbat? For people who support gay marriage? For people who fight against Hashem and curse the Torah every day? For them, they should vote. What's the alternative? You have bad and you have much worse. Who should you vote? You must vote for one. Who do you vote? You vote for bad or you vote for a million times worse? Bad, in this case, become the good. Right or wrong? Right? If a person, two people wants to harm you. One wants to give you a smack like that, and the other one wants to chop your head off. Who do you want to be your friend for the next hour? The one that would smack you. Why? Since when you like to be smacked? Believe me, when you see these ISIS crazy terrorists, this guy, my enemy, now became my best friend. Make sense or no? It's like the kids. They know they have to get punished for their marks, but they rather get punished from the mother, not the father. So they run to show it to the mother. Why? So one of them I will have to deal with. Who should I deal with? Sometimes it's the other way around. Sometimes the father is the, you know, and the mother is the tough general. But more, usually the mother always has more mercy. Moshe, please understand him. Don't give him a punishment. You know, this is how it works usually. So he says that my father won't give you any justice. You know, you have to endorse me. And after that, I'm gonna support you very well. The Gemara in Masechet Sota, page 9, the Gemara says that Avshalom stole 3 hearts, meaning deceived 3 people. Who did he deceive? He deceived his father, he deceived Sanhedrin, the 71 Chachamim, that was the Supreme Court of Israel back in the days. And he deceived the nation of Israel. That's why his punishment was that he got measure for measure. Everything that Hashem does to the wicked people, always measure for measure. Also to the righteous people, when they do something wrong. It's always midah keneged midah. So what happened, what was the end of Avshalom? Three spears went into his heart. They killed him by sticking three big spears into his heart, and that's how he died. Measure for measure, three hearts you stole, three spears went into your heart. Always measure for measure. Many times the way a person dies in a sudden death, if it's a slow process death, that's because Hashem wants to give the person enough time to do tshuva. And the suffering will help to clean his sins if he does tshuva. Sudden death, it's a punishment. Sudden death, how it was the death. For instance, car accident, stoning, airplane crash. That means all four executions in one shot. When the explosion goes, it's the fume and the fire, it's burning. The fume is choking. The pieces who fly and hit the heads of the people are stoning. And the holes that it makes inside the body, all kinds of metals that fly and make holes, that's sword. All together, arba mitot bedin in one shot. Because the Gemara says, since the Beit HaMikdash was destroyed, the temple, there's no more Sanhedrin, there's no more executions. What happened to all the people that deserve execution according to the Torah? That HaKadosh Baruch Hu replaced the execution with his own execution. You don't need the Beit Din to do it. That Hashem does it to the people on his own ways. However, it's the same thing. If a person deserves stoning, he will fall from a high ladder. Boom, on the floor. If a person needs choking, so instead of choking in Beit Din, he would drown in the lake or in the ocean, or from gas, he will choke. So the same thing, it always has to be. Choking is going to be choking, but in a different way of choking. It can be modern choking. It doesn't have to be like the old days. It can be modern stoning. If all people who jump from the twins, from the 100th floor, you saw how people were jumping and they crashed. One of them, by the way, survived. One didn't die, but all the other people crashed to pieces. That's exactly how stoning used to be, lo aleinu. When you see these things, you get goosebumps. Always you have to think, God forbid, what happened if it would be me? Smart person, when you see an accident, right away says, thank you, God, that it's not me. Imagine, God forbid, if it would be me. Right away wakes you up to do tshuva. And don't let the fools confuse you by saying, fear it's not the right way. You have to do it out of love, buddy, not out of fear. Yeah? If we're going to wait for that love to come, we may never get there. Better to wake up from fear than not to wake up at all. You understand? It's also a very high level. To fear Hashem, it's an honor. It's not an embarrassment. Remember, I said it many times in the past. To fear people, you're right, it's not kavod. To fear the police, to fear animals, of course. But to fear Hashem, is any better honor than that? It's big kavod. It should be praise for fearing Hashem, not chas v'shalom, make fun of. So, you know, that's how he died. He got the three spears in his heart, and that's what the end of him. Also, the Sanhedrin people, they were convinced by Avshalom with his smooth mouth that David puts them down. He doesn't hold highly of them. He wrote a letter, fake letter. He faked a letter. And this letter, he showed them that supposedly King David was the one who signed on it. And 200, he got to the point that based on that letter, they were convinced that he's right, that King David is not holding any, like, look, he doesn't even ask for your advice. Look, he doesn't even want you to sign. He does whatever he wants. He ignores his government completely. He doesn't care. So because of that, he was able to convince 200 people to back him up. That's how bad he was. That's a little bit similar to Korach and Adato. Korach got 250 people against Moshe Rabbeinu, even though they heard God speaking to Moshe and not to Korach. They heard that Hashem made him the leader, but they still were foolish enough to go, thank you, to go and attack Moshe and Aaron based on the smooth talking of Korach. And what was their end? It didn't help them that they were fooled by Korach. Each one of them went to with Korach together to the same section in hell. Both, all of them. They didn't get less than him. You may think you were the leader of this conspiracy. You're the one who convinced all the fools to follow you. You tricked them. You deceived them. They're not as bad as you. It wasn't their idea. You're the one behind everything. Your punishment should be a lot worse than them. If they get 10 years in prison, you have to get 30. That's the way it's working in this world. The one who organized the attack, the ones who put it together, always will get a bigger punishment. But we see that when it comes to machloket, fighting against the righteous people, there's no discount. As soon as you join the rasha against the tzaddik, your punishment is just as big as the Rasha. No discount whatsoever. And that was the end of them. So let's read some of the words of this Mizmor. Le David, this is a song that David wrote. Riva Hashem et Yerivai. Please, God, fight against my enemies. Lecham et Lochamai. Fight against the warriors that fights against me. החזק מגן וצינה וקומה בעזרתי. Hold a shield and protection and stand to save me. הרק חנית וסגור לקראת רוטפי. Pull your spear from the pouch and block the way to those who chase me. אמור לנפשי ישועתך אני. Say to my soul, I am your savior. Yevoshu v'ikalmu mevakshei nafshi. Those who are after me should be ashamed and disappointed. Yisogu achor, turn around and run. Ve'yachperu choshvei ra'ati. They'll be so ashamed, those who want to arm me. Yiyu kemotz lifnei ruach. Make them like straw that flies in the wind. Straw, it's very light. If you throw straw in the air, even in the weakest wind, it flies far. It's not something heavy that you need strong wind. It's one of the lightest things in the creation, straw. You throw a few pieces like feathers. It flies far away. So he says, make them fly away like the motz, like the straw in the wind. Umalach Hashem doche, that the angel of Hashem is blowing and make them go far away. Yehi darkam choshech, may their way be darkness, v'chalaklakot, full of traps. You know traps? Like in the snow. Ice over here, hole over there, ice under the snow, a pile of snow over here, especially at night, you keep falling. U'malach Hashem rotfam, and the angel of Hashem is trapping them and chasing them. Ki chinam tamnu li shachat rishtam. Because you know, for no reason, they set a hole and a trap to hunt me. They torturing me for no reason. I've done nothing wrong. Tevoehu shoah. Remember, he's referring to Achitofel, which was a very big chacham in Torah. Tevoehu Shoah lo yeda. This is the first time you have the word Shoah, Holocaust. In Hebrew, there's the Holocaust Day, Yom HaShoah, the Holocaust Day. This word in English, it's Holocaust, but in Hebrew, Shoah, it's a massive tragedy. Not just a tragedy, a real massive tragedy that words can describe. So he's wishing Achitofel to get a mass tragedy, not just to, you know, to have a punishment, to give him exactly what he deserves. Why? So many years I trust you, I tell you all my secrets, I help you, I endorse you, I support you, I sit with you in a room, I make you like the king of the world. and now you go with my son to go against me and to go again after my wife's? Is such a thing can be heard? Verishto asher taman, and the net that they put, that he puts, this Achitofel, til kedo beshoai polba, the same net that he put to hunt me will hunt himself. Venavshi tagil b'Hashem, and my soul will rejoice in God. Tasis b'Yishuato, will be happy with praising and thanking Hashem for his salvation. Tasis, I just made a lecture a few days ago. It's called 10 ways of happiness. 10 different ways of happiness. The word happiness is the word that repeats in the Torah more than any other words in different variations. Like you have sason, simcha, gil, you know, a lot of words that each one of them mean happiness, but there's always a little bit of a difference between one word to another. They're not equal. So there are 10 different ways of happiness in the Tanakh. Sas, like we say when we get married, in a Sheva Brachot, Sos tasis v'tagela akara, right? So what does it mean, Sos tasis? It's happiness that it's coming from inside and explode in a big noise and movement, something that you cannot hide. Simcha means internal happiness. You just want the lottery, but you don't want the rabbis around you to find out. So you don't go crazy. They ask you, what happened, Moshe? I just want $300 million. You know, tomorrow you're going to have a line all the way from here to Brooklyn. So you want to explode, but you're forcing yourself to pretend business as usual. Soon as you walk out of the shul, you begin to run like Meshuga in the streets, breaking home, your wife. You kiss her after 20 years that she forgot what it is. All of a sudden, you become very nice. But you just won the lottery. 2 minutes later, they call him. We made a mistake. It's someone with the same name, but not you. No, it's just a story. It never happened. Relax. So He said that my soul will have such happiness from the salvation that you're going to do for me. Kol atzmotai tomarna Hashem mi kamocha. Every one of my bones will scream, Hashem, there's no one like you. Matzil ani mi chazak mimeno ve'ani ve'evyon mi gozlo. Matzil ani, saving the weak. Ani has few meanings. Ani means someone that doesn't have money, broke, poor. Ani also means weak, someone weak that doesn't have abilities. Ani can come in different variations also. Here it's meaning, the meaning of the word ani here, it means chalash, weak. Matzil ani michazak mimeno. You save the weak person from someone that is stronger than him. Ve'ani ve'evyon migozelo. The second ani referring to actually poor financially. Ve'ani ve'evyon. What's the difference between ani and evyon? Both of them means poor financially. But it has to be a different. Remember, there's no two similar words. So what's the difference? Evyon is someone, ani has at least something that is dignity, doesn't get hurt. Yeah, he doesn't have enough. He needs to beg. People give him money. He collects donation. But he has the minimum thing that he needs. He has. He has something to wear. You know, he has, the minimum things that he needs, like bread, water, something to survive. He has. Evyon doesn't even have that. That's how bad is his situation. So you save those weak people, helpless people, from someone who come to attack them. Megozlo, gazlan. Someone who openly come to attack them and take the little that they have. Yekumun edei Hamas. False witnesses are rising with lies. Asher lo yadati ish'aluni. They're asking me about certain sins, supposedly that I made it, but I have no idea what they're talking about. Now remember, he's talking to Hashem. When a sinner wants to protect his reputation, so he tells all his friends and the people around him, it wasn't me. Of course it wasn't me. What, you believe this Lashon Hara? Come on, what's wrong with you? I promise you, some of them were willing to go even far as swearing just to clean their name. But if a person prays now Shmona Esrei to Hashem and he wants to confess about his sin, so he say when he prays, Hashem, I'm so sorry I did what I did. Imagine a person pray to Hashem, dear God, you know what they're blaming me, I never did. And you know he did it. Do you know anyone that will be that foolish? Standing to Hashem, say, you know what they're blaming me, I'm not the one who stole, you know it. What do you mean? You're the one. You can ask, help me, give me the strength to return it, help me never to do it again, forgive me for what I've done. That's okay, that's legit. But to come to Hashem, you know I never did it, they're making up stories about me. Do you think David HaMelech is so foolish to stand in front of Hashem and say, you know what, they're blaming me, I have no idea what they're talking about. That means he never did it. And how do we know that he never did it? Because Hashem say, my servant David, Mashiach come from him. If he was Rasha, if he was a sinner. The Gemara say the story with Bathsheba. Kol ha'omer David chata eino ela toeh. We explained it in previous lectures. He never made a sin. In his level, he didn't look good, the whole story. But he never made any sin from the Torah. The Gemara say, possible that David made a sin with a married woman and Hashem praising him so much and loving him so much? Hashem cannot look at a person who went with a married woman. Usually every person who went with a married woman doesn't have one happy day after that in the rest of his life. Check the world and see. Everything that they had blessing in will all collapse. Nothing, no health, no parnasa, problems with the children. If they were single, usually they die single. If they finally got married, it's a short marriage and divorce. There's really no tolerance to that sin. It's actually the worst sin you can think of. Worse than a murder. You know, even a murderer can do tshuva easier than someone who went with a married woman that belongs to another man. And unfortunately today, people are not aware of such a horrible crime. If people would know, they'd say, what, for the excitement and the pleasure of the scene, I'm going to pay such an endless price. It's not worth it. But the Satan is a genius. What do you think? He's going to push you to a single girl? If he already make the scene, he'll always push you to someone that the scene is a thousand times bigger. Because even among the sins, there's different rating of sins, like the Rambam writes. Sometimes one sin equal like a thousand. Sometimes one mitzvah equal like a thousand. That's why I always tell people, invest in Kiruv. Sponsor CDs constantly. Sponsor CDs with every penny of your money. Why? No other mitzvah comes to the same category. Every mitzvah is a one-time deal. Money is gone, the mitzvah is finished. Sponsoring CDs makes a lot of people become religious. The people become religious, they continue to do mitzvot for the rest of their life and their children and grandchildren and 10, 20, 30 generations until the end of time. People will keep mitzvot thanks to the grandfather that became religious from your money. You make billions and trillions of mitzvot as opposed to one. There's nothing to compare here. That's all you should invest in. I'm taking full responsibility. You come in front of Hashem, you say that you listen to what I say, and I'm standing behind it 1,000,000%, with no hesitation whatsoever. Sometimes in life, there's hesitation. There's two mitzvot, you're not sure. Maybe this one is better, maybe this one. Yes, there are cases like this. But here, you know, it's like two opponents. One opponent is in the sky, one of them is in the bottom. There's nothing to even compare. It's not, you compare this to him, come on. If the 55-45, now, it's almost equal. Okay, now we have a dilemma. But this is in the millions and this is in the singles. You're comparing them? There's nothing to even compare here. So he continues here and he says, Kol atzmotai tomarna Hashem mikamocha, all my bones will praise you and say, who is like you, God? You always save the weak and the poor from those who attack them. False witnesses are rising to attack me. They paying me bad for the good I did for them. Ungrateful people. Shechol lenafshi, yeshalmuni ra'atacha tova. They'll pay me bad for all the good that I did. And they're asking to kill me. Not only they want to see me falling. It's not enough for them. When I'm on the floor, when they see me now sick, instead of letting me go, say, okay, leave him. And he got what we wanted. Leave him. They're not resting until they see me dead. Why? Menasim lehafoch oti lehafoch oti le-shakul. You know, we say in Hebrew, families that lost one of their sons in a war, they call it mishpachot shakulot. Mishpacha means family. Shakul, shchol, come from losing someone dear that died in a family, lo alenu. So it says, shechol lenafshi. They're asking to kill me. They're trying to make my family mishpacha shakula by killing me. Vani b'chalotam levushi sak, and me, when they were sick, when these people were sick, when they needed help, I wore a sack. I was fasting for them. Ineti betzom nafshi. I used to fast for them. I used to pray for them. I wore a sack. I mourned. I did everything I could to help their health. And look what they're paying me back. What are they paying me back? Giving advice against me to destroy me. And when I'm finally collapsing, they now want to see me dead. Do you understand what's going on here? It's not so rare in today's world. You have people, you give your life for them, and in the end, they do things to you that you cannot believe. You wonder to yourself, how can it be? Utfilati al cheki tashuv, and my prayers that I prayed for them, they didn't deserve it to begin with. Make it come to me now. I need those prayers. Don't give it to them. Take the prayers that I did for them and take it away from them and give it to me. Put it in my account, not theirs. Because when you pray for your friend, all your prayers goes to consideration in his situation, in his file. You understand? If there is a decree that he should die from cancer, God forbid. Now he has 2-3 more months to live. If one person pray for him, it goes into his file. You open the computer, you see his name, 3 more months to live, the cancer is growing every day. But one person start to pray for him every day, Tehilim, it goes to the account. Everything is like a scale. If 10 people pray for him, if 100 people pray for him, if 1,000 people pray for him, if all Am Yisrael pray for him, it's very, very serious weight on the other side. It can overcome the problem completely. And that's the power of the prayers, the more people. Now, sometimes it's not necessarily quantity, how many people pray for them. It's the quality of the people. If one very big tzaddik pray for them, it can be equal like 1,000 other mouths. Or someone that has a lot of merits, that he has millions of things that were done in the world thanks to him. He taught many people Torah, they became rabbis, and they teach Torah. Or he make many people religious, and these people make so many mitzvot, and all their mitzvot goes to his account. Even if it is not the biggest tzaddik in the world, or far away from that, but the merit of that person is so huge, that when he asks Hashem to have mercy on this person, then they take it to consideration. There's no guarantee, because Hashem does in the end what he feels the right thing to do. But that can help a lot to those people. In Israel, there was a case, there's many cases like this, but there was a case, one person used to make a lot of people religious. In one of his speeches, one woman got up and she said to him, Rabbi, I became religious and I cover my hair. No, I keep Shabbat, I keep this, I go to the mikveh. and me and my husband cannot have kids for 15 years. She said, is it fair that all these Jewish girls that betrayed Hashem and married the Arab terrorist here in Israel, they have 16, 17 terrorist kids that comes one after the other to the world like rats. They're coming one after the other. And me, that I do what you want, you're not giving me even one kid? So he told her, do you cover your hair? She said, no. He said, if you accept on you to cover your hair, I'll make a special prayer for you now, and Bezrat Hashem, you have a kid. 9 months after that, she had a baby. Then they made another videos, and after 15 years, she couldn't become pregnant. And Baruch Hashem, we've seen these cases many, many times. And that's the power of a blessing that comes from a person that has merits, zchuyot. So over here, he say, I need these merits now. Why did I give it to these wicked people? They don't deserve to live, bechlal. Take it. Everything I prayed for them was based on the assumption that they are kosher. But now when I see who this Achitofel is, he deserves to get the worst punishment, doesn't deserve to get prayers. Take it away and give it to me. We have a concept in life. If a person committed to do something based on X information, and later he found out that the information that he had at the time that he committed was all false, the condition is canceled. It's not a neder, it's not a vow. For instance, if he thought that this rabbi is a kosher person, he thought he's kosher. And he said to him, I'm going to help you, I'm going to give you, I'm going to do. And then he found out he's not. Not suspicion. Really proof, no doubt whatsoever. He doesn't have to give him a penny. But he has to give the money to the same cause. If the cause was for yeshiva, he has to give it to a different yeshiva. He's not getting away with the neder. But he can switch from the non-kosher one to a kosher one. But it has to be the same level of tzedakah. If it's yeshiva, it cannot go from yeshiva to shul. Because yeshiva is much, much higher than a shul. It's nothing to compare. So you cannot lower the value of the tzedakah. You can only increase. If you committed to a shul, and now you found out that the person who wants the money there is not a kosher person, you can either give to another shul, which is equal, or you can give to yeshiva. No problem, yeshiva is better. So all the promises you ever made, if you find out that they're not kosher, you can always switch it to kiruv, to save souls, to give CDs to people, you know, to help people become religious, because it's the highest cause, the highest. So therefore, no matter what you switch to that, it's always uplifting the mitzvah and not downgrading the mitzvah. Okay, so he's concluding over here. All the prayers that I gave for them, al cheki tashuv, will return to me. Kerea keachli italachti. I was like a loved friend, like a brother. I treated them. I treated them in the nicest way. Ka'avel em koder shachoti. When they were sad, I was sad with them. When they were down, I was down with them. When I walk crippled, I hurt my leg. If I'm crippled, right? When I walk, they're happy. They pretend, oh, David, what's wrong with your leg? Oh, we're so sorry to see it. And in their heart, they are so happy. Hypocrite people. All the wicked people, nechim, neche means a handicapped person. Nechim means handicaps, plural. But the nechim also has different level. It means not as perfect as the normal. That's really what it means. So when you say neche, that means it doesn't have a complete body. He has one defect in his body. Doesn't have a leg, cannot walk, doesn't have a hand, lost a finger. You know, that's all called nechut. But neche, it could be also neche ruach, someone that is down, sad, depressed. right? Ruach necha'ah, it's called. And also it can be crooks, that people supposed to be, people, thank you. People supposed to be honest, the majority of the world, and here you go, you have a crooked person. So he's calling him Neche. Nechim ne'esfu alai, they're all around me, all these crooks. Ve'lo yadati, and I did not know all along that they are crooks. I trusted them. Kar'u ve'lo damu, they rip their clothes like they feel bad for me, but they're actually happy inside. Bechanfe la'age ma'og, with chanufa, kissing up, but they actually make fun at me behind my back. Ma'og, it's a party. They make a party when they see me suffer. Not in my face, but after that. Charok alai shinemo. It's like, you know, when a fox is about to attack the chicken, so the second before he swallow him, he opens big mouth and you see his teeth. You know how the animals are, the lions? When they open up, the lips goes up and you finally see how horrible is their teeth. That's an expression, it's in Hebrew, it's called chorek shinav, like making the teeth, like ready to bite. Charok alai shinemo, they're opening their jaws to bite me. Adonai kama tireh, Hashem, how long you can see and still stand still? How long it will take until you react? Ashiva nafshi mishoehem mikfirim yechidati. Release my soul from the trap that they set for me, from the lions who are about to swallow me. Odecha beka'al rav. After you save me, I will make a great gathering and I will thank you in front of a large audience. From here we have a law in Judaism of what we call se'udat odaya. When a person had a miracle, he makes a big thing and he thanks Hashem in public. Today the custom is to read Nishmat Kol Chai, because it's all thanking Hashem. Ilu pilu male shira kayam, ulshonenu, shira, en anachnu maspikim leodot lecha. We cannot thank you enough. So this song that we say in the Tefillah of Shabbat, before we say Baruchu, minute before, that's a very good way to thank Hashem. So odecha bekaal rav. I won't thank you in front of three friends. I won't thank you next to my children only. I will thank you in front of the whole huge audience. Be'am atzuma aleleka. I will praise you. I will sing praises to you in front of a huge nation. Everyone will be there when I thank you for saving me. Al ismechu li oyvai sheker. Don't let the enemies, the false people, to be happy. Sonai chinam ikretzu ayin. How they wink with their eyes, these tricky people. Ki lo shalom yedaberu, they don't come with peace. Al rigei eretz divrei mirmot yachashovun, they come to the naive, innocent people planning all the tricks behind their back. Ve'archivu alai pihem, they open their mouth against me. Amru e'ach, e'ach ra'ata enenu. Each means it's a joy. It's shouting with joy. Ach, hey, like they say in English, hooray, hooray. That's what he's talking about. That's how happy they are. Ra'ita Hashem al techerash. Hashem, you see all of that. Please don't be quiet. Adonai al tirchak mimeni. Don't go far away from me. Ha'ira ve'akitza lemishpati. Wake up and rush the judgment of my enemies. Elohai v'Adonai, my master and my God, l'rivi, to judge those who fight me. Shofteni ketzitkecha, judge me with your honesty. He knows he's not guilty, he knows he's perfect. He asks Hashem to judge him. We cannot say to Hashem, judge me. If he'll judge us, we won't be here. But he could, because he knew he doesn't make any sins. He said to Hashem, Adraba, please, judge me now. If you find me guilty, remember in previous lecture, he said, if Shaul is right and I'm guilty, not only I don't want you to save me from Shaul, I want you to make him find me with a soldier throw me on the floor, step over my head, and kill me in a worse death. Can we say it to Hashem, if I'm right and my enemy is wrong, save me. But if I'm wrong and my enemy is right, make him find me and kill me in the middle of the street in front of everyone? We won't say it, because even if we know we are wrong, we are not 100% living according to the truth and the standards of Hashem. But this is a soul here of a legend. What does he say? Shofteni, judge me right now. Why? If you judge me now, I know I'll win. I know who they are, and I know who I am. I know I'm right. Al yomru belibam each nafshenu. Shut their mouth that this world horei will never come out of her anymore. Al yomru belanuhu. Don't let them come and say we swallowed him, which is an expression of we won, we destroyed him. Yevoshu veyechperu yachdav. They should be ashamed and embarrassed together. Smechei ra'ati, all those who gather together against me. Ilbeshu voshet, they will put a different outfit. What's the name of the new outfit? Shame. Uchlima, המגדילים עליי, that because of what they do to me. יערונו וישמחו חפצי צדקי, those who wants to protect me, those who wants to help me, should be happy and should be judged with justice. ויאמרו תמיד יגדל השם מחפץ שלום עבדו. They will always say, the name of Hashem would praised and raised, החפץ שלום דוד עבדו. Hashem will always benefit his servant David. ולשוני תהגה צדקך, and my tongue will always tell your greatness, your righteousness. כל היום תהילתך, all day I'm praising you. We finished chapter 35, as you can see how long it was. Because this was written on one of the most substantial incident in the life of David HaMelech. His life was 70 years. He had few big incidents in his life. One day he went to fight against Goliath. That was a critical day. When Shaul was chasing him to kill him, that was a critical incident. When Avshalom rebelled against him, that's another critical incident. When Nathan the prophet came to him and said to him, the story, the parable of Kifsat Arash, the sheep of the poor person. That was also a serious thing. Like, well, what did you do? You send Uriah to the wall and you took Bathsheba. So all these things, there were enough. There was enough substantial incidents in the life, in a short life, we should say. 7 years is not that long. In a short life of David HaMelech. Now we have some time to do another Mizmor. Mizmor chapter number 36. We will give a summary of this Mizmor. This Mizmor is talking about the contradiction between the leadership of the wicked person to the leadership of the righteous person. That's very good for today's when we fight in politics. There's wars between politicians. Even though it's almost impossible to be a perfect politician, to be righteous, there's so many tests and so many obstacles and so much in it that it's almost impossible to be pure. But it's almost impossible, meaning it's still possible. It's not easy, it's very difficult, but it's still possible. Now, everybody knows when your king is righteous, how wonderful the life of all citizens. And when a king is evil and crooked and wicked, how horrible it could be. The Ben Ish Chai brought a story about a Jewish boy, 16 years old, who wanted to be a waiter for the king. And that king was a very evil, cruel king. And he was paying triple than being waiter anywhere else, the king. He was paying okay. But if you make one mistake, right away he executes you. He's so evil, you make one mistake in your job, you break a plate, you spill something on someone, right away execution. So the Jews told this boy, are you crazy? You want to go to work for this evil king? You shouldn't do such thing. So he said, I need the money. I'll be good, don't worry, nothing will happen to me. One day when the king's sitting in front of the whole nation, this boy is bringing soup. He's bringing soup directly towards the king. As soon as he arrived to the king, one tiny drop of the soup flew from the bowl right into the soup, in a shirt of the king. Boom, he had a stain. As the king looked at his shirt in his big party in front of everyone, he gave him the look, the famous look that everybody knows. Once the king gives this look, everybody begins to say, Gadal v'itkadash merabah, right away. So the boy is finished, and the boy realized it. So what did the boy say? If I'm already going to die, he took the whole bowl, spilled it in the face of the king. In his face, on his shirt, everywhere in front of thousands of people. Everyone, complete silence. You know how it is? Oh, shh, silence. Even a fly stopped flying from the shock. When the king saw it, not only gave him a look, he began to shout, take him right away to the hanging pole. Right away, not tomorrow, right away. And the whole nation followed the king and the police, they taking him. When they put the rope around his neck, the king was dying to know where this chatzuf had this audacity to do such thing. So he said to him, listen, I've seen a lot of stupid people in my life, but how did you have this nerve to spill the soup on a king? So the Jew told him, Your Majesty, I know you think that I have something against you, but in reality, it's the total opposite. I love and admire you very much. That's why I spilled the soup on you. So he said to him, what? No, you don't make any sense. So he told him, listen, when I came to serve you the soup, I was so happy I have the honor to serve you with the soup. What can I do? It wasn't in my hand. One drop flew, fell on your shirt. You gave me that look. Everyone knows that the next day I'll be dead. And what do you think would happen here? All the nation would say, what a cruel king we have. No justice, no righteousness, nothing. He killed an innocent waiter for such innocent mistake. Is that the king we want? Everyone would hate you here. So when it happened and I knew you're going to kill me and I don't deserve to die, I wanted to make myself deserve to die, that at least no one would speak against you after you killed me. So I spilled it on you, and now everyone is so happy that you're killing me and they will praise you that you're doing the right thing. So I kept your honor in front of the nation. You know, your dignity, your honor, thanks to what I did, will be reserved that you are a good king and you're doing the right thing. The king got the shock of his life. He said, take off this rope away. I want you to come be my son. He took him to the palace. He made him his advisor. The Beis Lishchai brought this story as Chaim ve'amavet beyad ha'lashon. Life and death depend on one word, what comes out of your mouth. The right word, the next word, So the next mizmor is speaking about the leadership of a wicked person to the leadership of a righteous person. Not necessarily king, any leader. Darko shel harasha kula ma'asim ra'im ben adam lechavero. Wicked person that has no fear from God, only hurt people, take advantage of people, steal from people, don't pay them what they deserve, speak bad against them, never appreciate what people do for him. Any given hour, he has at least one crime against somebody. So all of these things that he has no fear from God cause him to do more and more bad. This is what the Torah say, Rak en irat Elokim b'makom hazeh v'haraguni. That's what Abraham say. There's no fear from God in this place. I'll be dead soon. I cannot expect from them anything. And so we're speaking here about a wicked person here that his heart is so tight, so hard, that even fear from suffering and tragedies he doesn't have. Not only doesn't have fear from Hashem, nor respect to Hashem, even if he becomes sick and he knows he can die from the sickness, still doesn't make him scared from what about to come to him. It's very, very common today. People already see the fire of Gehenom and they still have all kinds of hallucinations that they come out of it. And when you tell them, do tshuva, make tshuva, maybe Hashem will have mercy on you. Ah, Hashem, whatever what I have, it's nature, it's nothing to do with Hashem. That's how they answer. Even though in a hospital, almost everyone is religious. You don't believe me, go to York Avenue, over there in 67, 68, whatever. Walk inside and make a survey. Go from one room to another, from all the patients, Jews and non-Jews. Ask him, tell me, do you believe in God? He said, of course, all of them. What? And some of them are the ones who used to shout and scream against Hashem, or to make fun. Now, when they are like that, it's a different story, misfortune and situation. So let's see what this Mizmor has to teach us about life. Chapter 36 is describing a war between a servant of Hashem, which is David in this case, between him to the evil inclination, to the Satan, that confused the wicked people every minute of their life. There's no din ve no dayan, no judgment. Don't worry. As long as you don't get caught by the police here and the government does not know about what you do, you got away with that. There's nothing to worry about. Don't worry, Hashem. Don't worry about punishment. The religious people made it up. Who said that whatever the conscience that tells us, it's a Jewish invention? Do you know? Do you know or not? When they interview Adolf Hitler, Yimach Shimo Vezichro, he said, two defects Judaism brought to humanity. One in a body, one in a soul. I acknowledge the soul. I know some Jews that deny the existence of the soul. That's how low they are. He, at least, this monster, knew that there is body and soul. But he said Judaism brought two defects, one to the body, one to the soul. To the body, circumcision. Person is born, right away they make a defect in the body. He didn't know it's the other way around. A person is born with a defect, circumcision make him perfect. He didn't know. He doesn't. What does he know? He learned Torah. And the second thing that he said is, and the defect that they brought to the soul is inventing the term conscious. It's a Jewish invention. Why? Let us do whatever we want without feeling guilty. I don't feel anything guilty. I see kids going into the gas chambers. Doesn't bother me at all. I see women, people screaming. Doesn't even bother me. Makes me feel great. He doesn't have a heart. Why? Monster. But how his conscience died? He convinced himself that all the feelings he may have inside, such as mercy and regret, or, you know, second thoughts, it's all because he learned it from the Jews. They made it up. There's really no such thing conscious. Don't let it fool you. So this Mizmor is speaking about people not to that extent. It doesn't have to be a murderer to be wicked, but to people who constantly do bad things and they say, end in ven dayan. Enough with your stories, Rabbi. I know if we will die, we all become sand, there's nothing to worry about. And how they back up their nonsense? By telling you, ma, religious people don't get cancer. Religious people, some of them don't have kids. Religious people, some of them are broke, they don't have money. What are you telling me? Because we are not keeping Shabbat, we're not keeping mitzvot, that's why we're sick. The answer to these people is, what you see in reality many, many times is not the truth. It looks one thing, and it's still, for instance, you look up to the sky, it looks blue. But the sky is not blue, the sky is black. When you fly above the atmosphere, everything is black. It's an illusion that with the light of the sun, it looks blue. But it's really not blue, it's all black. There are many things in life that looks like one thing, but they are really the other way. We don't go by what our eyes see. That's a very common mistake. It's important, of course, we have five senses that we have to decide what to do based on the information that the senses providing us. But one, there's one sense that is above our five senses. What is it? The Torah. The Torah, it's the general shelter. You know, you have many switches. Touching, smelling, seeing, you know, all these, the senses that we have is switches, but there's a main shelter, the main switch. Doesn't matter what the switches are. If even if all of them are on, if you turn off the top switch, they're all worthless. The top switch, it's a spiritual switch. What is it? Like they call it in Hebrew, Achush HaShishi, the sixth sense. What is it? It's the divine knowledge, the divine information. That's it. So if you have a divine book, and every fool, if he analyzes it carefully enough, will know that a person was unable to write such a book. If a person holds in his hand the book that was given to humanity by the creator of the world, he has no permission to move one tiny percent from the truth of that book, regardless of what he feels, whether he agree with that, he disagree with that, people taught him otherwise, his heart doesn't let him digest it, doesn't matter what he thinks. It's me against the book. The book always wins. The book is the computer of Hashem. The computer of Hashem doesn't make mistakes. I am the one who has problems understanding. But when I come, my opinion clash with something the Torah say, the Torah is right, not what I think. So therefore here, the Torah said that because of sins, people get sick. It's a verse in the Torah. And I want to remind you, I didn't write the Torah. It wasn't my opinion. The Torah say, "Kol ha-machala asher samti b'mitzrayim lo asim alecha ki ani Hashem rofecha." All the sicknesses that I sent to the people in Egypt, I will not bring to you, because I am your God, your doctor. But in another place he say that if you're not going to listen to me, I will send you this disease and that disease, have even diseases that you never heard of, I will send you in the future. So it leaves no doubt that sicknesses comes and go only from Hashem, not from nature. Nature is a tool in the hand of the carpenter. The carpenter wants to make a chair. He needs a ratchet and plier and hammer and nails. There's only the tool in the hand of the carpenter. The carpenter is the one who designs and does everything, not the tools. So the point is that Hashem used nature to make people get all kinds of things. There's only one sickness the Gemara teach that doesn't come from Hashem. What is it? If you catch a cold. If you get cold, that's because of your negligence. You didn't wear a coat, you went to cold place, windy, you're not dressed warm enough, you didn't protect your eyes and ears, then you can get cold. That cold that you got wasn't a punishment. It was your foolishness. Why are you doing things to bring cold on yourself? But any other disease, you can never get it before Hashem approved it. If he did not approve it, you'll not get it. That's why sometimes you stand in front of a person that have germs and he sneezes in your face and in your friend's face. Both of you got the germ. He got it and you don't get it. Or the other way around. You the next day with 120 fever, and your friend is jogging on the beach. How are you, Moshe? This guy sneezed, he made me sick. He sneezed on me also, why I'm not sick? Because Hashem wanted you here, and he didn't want him there. Do you know that you can get, God forbid, you can get a sickness from a person, even a life risk sickness, and that person doesn't have and never had that sickness in his whole life? Did you know that or no? I'll give you an example of what I mean. A person that has HIV, it can develop to AIDS and then the person die. He can make somebody else catch the HIV. He can make someone else get it. The person who would get it from him can die in 2 years while he's still alive for another 20 years, the other one. Why it's developed in his body and not in him, only Hashem knows. The Gemara say, don't drink leftover water from someone's mouth in his glass. This was 2,000 years ago. Why it can risk your life? The Gemara already was aware of germs way before science discovered them. Way before. You know, maybe 1,700 years before. The Gemara say the person that drank can have a sickness. When he left some water in a cup, you can drink from that water and you can die. But how can you die if he doesn't die? Because in his body, the germs are sleeping. They're not active. As soon as it enters your body, it became active and it can kill you in a week. And that's very interesting because the science never dreamed about this 2,000 years ago. But it's written in the Talmud. Now, let's continue and finish this mizmor and we'll be done. So, chapter 36, as I said, speaking about the war between the servant of Hashem, David, to the evil inclination who convinced the wicked people there's no judgment and no judge, and always persuade them and influence them not to learn Torah. Chadal le'aski le'etiv. Stop with the good. Stop with chesed. Stop helping people. Don't be a fool. Why you always have to have guests in your homes? Why are you such a fool? Why you let people take advantage on you? Why you have to volunteer to drive people when they don't have a ride? Why and why and why? Very nice soldiers the Satan has. And he's hinting here to Goliath, and Pachad Elohim. He has no fear from God. Leneged Einav. There's no fear from God in front of his eyes. And also against Achitophel, that even though he was a Talmid Chacham and he knew a lot of Torah, Mikol Makom Haya Rasha. Bottom line, he was wicked. And he gave Avshalom a bad advice to take the Pilakshim of his father. Okay, let's see literally what this Mizmor mean. Lamnatzeach Le'eved Hashem LeDavid. This song was written by the servant of Hashem, David. Not everywhere it says, Eved Hashem. Lamnatzeach mizmor le-David. Over here there's an extra word. Lamnatzeach le-Eved Hashem, to the servant of Hashem, David. Nehum pesha la-rasha bekerev libi. The words, the speech of the Satan, the evil inclination to the wicked person inside his heart, speaking to his mind. I always like to give an example that the Satan is like a little midget that sits inside the brain and always whisper bad things for you to do. En pachad Elohim leneged enav. No fear from God in front of this Rasha. Ki echelik elav be'enav. He always tricky and, you know, smooth. Limtzo avonu lisno. That he always find negative things about everyone. Dibre piv aven umirma. Everything comes from his mouth. Is kfira, speaking against Hashem and the truth. And always lies. Chada leaski leetiv. Stop learning Torah. Stop doing good. If he ever did, the Satan will make sure not even one thing he will do. Aven yachshov al mishkavo, before he goes to sleep, he thinks only what negative he can do tomorrow. Ityatzev al derech lo tov, he enter a path that is very bad for him. Ra lo imas, everything that is negative and bad, he likes. Normal righteous people, when they see something bad, they run away from it. You take a good teenager. He comes to a room in a school where he goes, and he sees the kids doing drugs, lo aleinu, which is an epidemic today. Right away, he runs outside. He doesn't want to stand there 1 second. That's a kosher kid. And not such kosher kid, he stands and look like this. But he won't touch. And a bad kid, why are you not calling me? That's the difference between good, mediocre, and bad. Many of that has to do with the nature, with his tikkun in life. You know, the way, who he used to be in his previous life, he has the same traits. But many of that come from the education that he got in his home. If his parents gave him solid education as a kid, he will know to run away from negative characters. If not, only attracted to negative. I said to one of those kids a few days ago, I said to him, why all these negative people always come to you? Because he was complaining that he didn't invite them, they came to him. So I said to him, you know where the flies are attracted to? You know what goes in the bathroom? The flies attracted to them. The fly doesn't come to wonderful places. They only go to this. Because this is what you are, and that's why the flies comes to you. You understand? If you're gonna start dressed like a human being, and you're gonna start cut your stupid hair, and stop behaving like I don't wanna say what, you will see that they don't wanna stand near you. You're not cool anymore. They don't want you. They would leave you alone. You won't have to ask them to leave. Hey, buddy, what happened? You became a nerd. You're not cool like you used to be. You're right. What did he do the next day? Attract more flies. Some people have this habit. What comes in this ear goes right away from the other. And does not even stay to park inside his head one day even. Right away, as you speak, a minute later, did you even realize what I was telling you? What? You know what I'm talking about, no? Ay. No wonder, when I read the words of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, that he was crying, I don't want to be in the last generation before Mashiach come. I don't want to live in that generation. He already saw what's coming to us. So it says like this, it says here, L'amnatzeach le'eved le'david, ne'um pesha la'rasha bekerev libi, the Satan is whispering constantly to the wicked that have no fear from God, always winking, where to find, who to make fun at people, to take advantage on them. Divrei piv aven u'mirma, constant lies come from him. Stop to do the little good that he used to do. Before he goes to sleep, only negative things. Ityatzev al derech lo tov, what we call today off the derech, off the path, is in a different path right now. Ra lo imas, everything negative near him, not only that he is not sick from it or vomiting from that, he runs after that like it's the treasure. You understand? Usually, it happens to people by eating non-kosher food. That's one of the main reasons why secular people cannot hear the truth. You talk to them and you wonder to yourself, how can this person be so foolish? No, he's not foolish. Talk to him about math, he's a genius. Talk to him about sport, he will tell you each player, what's his birthday, what color pants he wore in 1973. But tell him one word of wisdom from the Torah, he's allergic. The blood is contaminated. It's made from non-kosher food. The manufacturer made a rule. In this car, you only put this gas. But they put a different gas. What happens to the car? It doesn't drive. That's what's going on. The blood comes from a negative source. Everything after is negative. The foundation is negative, everything after is negative. It's a chain reaction. One problem causes another one. It's like the liars. They make a lie, which will force them to lie a second one, and a third, and a fourth, and a fifth, and eventually maybe even to kill, to cover for their lies. Hashem b'shamayim chasdecha. Hashem, your chesed, your kindness is all the way up to the heaven. Emunatcha tshachakim, the faith, the words of yours is all the way up to the sky. Tzidkatcha ke'arerei hel, your righteousness is like big divine mountains, huge mountain. Mishpatecha te'om rabba, your sentences, your judgment is a very, very deep hole. Like, you know, the mountain, sometimes you have all the way down, you see? Wow, if the car falls there, what the end? Or if a person goes on an Empire State Building and look down, people look like little dots. Mishpatecha te'om rabba, the strictness of your judgment is so deep, so scary, so scary. Adam uve'ema toshiya Hashem. When you want to save someone, you'll save the man, you'll save the animal as well. When the dog crossed the street and someone came full speed, and in the last minute the dog moved or the guy, who do you think saved his life? Coincidence? Only Hashem. Adam uve'ema toshiya Hashem. Ma yakar chasdecha Elokim. How great is your kindness, God. Bnei Adam betzel knafecha yechesayun. People would hide under your wings. Yirveyun mideshen betecha. They'll be full from the greatness that you give them. Venachal adanecha tashke. And they drink from your spring. Ki imcha mekor chaim. You are the source of our life. Be'orcha nire or. In your glowing, we see the light of life. You are our spiritual sun. The sun shows you in this physical world, you know, where to go, what to do, colors, whatever. But your sun, your light, your glowing, showing the soul the right direction. Meshoch hasdecha leyodecha, throw from your kindness on those who knows you, those who follow you. Vetzidkatcha leishre lev, and from your righteousness, from your justice, to those who are honest in their heart. There's two levels of honesty. Some people, their honesty is only in their mouth. They think all kinds of things, but in the end they say the truth. Some people, even in their heart, they're honest. Their heart cannot think, heart meaning the mind, cannot think even one thing crooked. Can never think to steal, can never even have an option in his mind to try to steal or to lie or to say something to hurt a person or to say Lashon Hara. It doesn't even cross their mind. There are people like this in the world. Right away, as soon as somebody say that, they have the shock of their life. Ah, Rabbi, what are you so shocked? What are you shocked? Because you and him in a different level, in the heart. Al tevo'eni regel gaava. What does it mean? Don't send the proud, arrogant people to me. Don't bring the legs of the weeper of the proud people next to me. Save me from proud people. I don't want anything to do with them. People with ego, people with arrogance. Take their legs away from my direction, that they don't walk towards me. Ve'yad reshaim al teni deni, and the hands of the wicked people never to come near myself. Sham naflu po'alei aven, let them fall where they are. Don't bring them near me. I don't want any contact with them. Dochu ve'lo yachlu kum. Dochu means litchot, to push away. They'll be pushed away and they will not be able to rise back on their feet. We finish this mizmor, chapter 36. And Bezrat Hashem, I cannot start another chapter because it's pretty long. We'll have to keep it for next week. So Baruch Hashem, we're up to chapter 36. Any questions about what we spoke? If you have any, then I can answer, and if not, we can just finish right here. Any? We'll see you, Bezrat Hashem, next Wednesday, 8 o'clock. Baruch Adonai Le'olam. Amen v'amen.